Hey everyone, how's it going? Good evening. Today is, I want to say Sunday, but it's Monday evening. How's everybody doing? Just posted a bunch of new videos with rapper Garcia. Delilah, say hi. Say hi. If you guys want to call in, 818-522-0221. 818-522-0221. Hope everyone's doing well. The good news is, hi Delilah, come. Robert Garcia told me that he got calls from three different promoters that he works with. And the message basically was, boxing will be come back in the end of May, beginning of June. End of May, beginning of June, it looks like boxing will be returning. So if you're a fighter, start getting ready. If you're a fan, start getting excited. Delilah, come here. Rafael, the number is 818-522-0221. 818-522-0221. This is Delilah. She's an English bulldog. In July, she'll be four. Good girl. When I first got her, she was in a size of like a guinea pig. Let's see. What's up? I just turned on the phone if you guys want to call. 818-522-0221. So, Delilah. Yeah, so Robert told me end of May, beginning of June, it looks like boxing will be back at some format. They're not sure exactly how or what will be the exact... what will be the exact setting of how they'll do it? Probably no fans and everyone will be tested. But it's good because boxing, I miss it. I want to see fights already. What's up? Do I think Mike Tyson would knock Wilder out right now if Tyson trained? No. Jeff Fennick, who I respect, who I like, who's my homie. Shout out to Jeff Fennick. He said that if Mike Tyson trained for 6 weeks, he'd beat Deontay Wilder. My answer was that he wouldn't beat Wilder now or in his prime. Yeah, I know Wilder just had a not the best performance against Tyson Fury, but anybody can have a bad day. Shout out to Chula Vista. It's near San Diego, Chula Vista, California. Mike Tyson is a legend, is an icon, but no, he's still in his 50s. I think, how old is Mike Tyson? Anybody knows the top of their head without Googling? I want to say Tyson's 55. But I may be off by a couple years. Boxing is a dangerous sport. He's 53. Okay. Boxing is a very dangerous sport. 52 or 53? 6 weeks of training. Training is not fighting. I've seen fighters look phenomenal in training. Phenomenal. But, you know, boxing is a young man's sport. What's up? Tijuana, one of my favorite places in the world. Been there many times. Shout out to TJ. Sparring is not fighting and training is not fighting. Delilah, come here. So let me ask you guys. If you had to pick the top four boxers in boxing history, who to you represents boxing? If you had to name four names, for me, it would be Muhammad Ali, Roberto Duran. It's so hard to just pick four. Duran, Ali, that's for sure. Pacquiao and Mayweather. Marciano, how could he be overrated? 49, no, he was a legit champ. He beat Joe Lewis. No, Marciano's not overrated. Chavez Jr. I mean, Chavez could be there too, of course. Ali, Tyson, Leonard, Chavez. Robert Garcia picked Ali, Leonard, Mayweather, and Duran. Happy 420, everybody, whoever's celebrating. You know what? It reminds me. Let me see if Frank the Cook is celebrating. Because he's all about 420, 24/7, 365. He's probably celebrating. Is Frank screening my calls again? I'm trying to call Frank the cook. Let's see, it's not, I'm not hearing you ring. Let's try again. He's, Frank is definitely celebrating 420. Let's see if he picks up. Hey, happy 420. It's your biggest holiday of the year.
My biggest holiday is Rosh Hashanah.
Frank is so stoned right now, he doesn't even know what day it is. What did you do for 420, Frank?
What?
What did you do for 420?
Eat a lot.
So he has the munchies. I interviewed Robert today, and Robert told me that 420 is a dumb holiday because people smoke every day. You don't need a special day for smoking out.
Well, before it used to mean something. Now it really doesn't matter.
So, Frank, you heard the big news? Yeah. You heard the big news?
What big news?
Robert told me that three different promoters called him, and they're all telling him that boxing will be back end of May, beginning of June. Are you ready to get sponsors? Are you ready to do ring walks? Are you ready to do announcements?
I'm ready. Where are they going? To all Florida?
No, they don't know yet. That hasn't come up yet.
That's good. I'm ready, man. I'm ready to get back to work.
Are you ready? But you can only go to the gym if you have a mask. You have to have your own Vaseline. You can't share gloves. You can't share anything. Your own jump rope, even.
Yeah, the boxers got to be careful, man. They probably can't hit the bags right by each other, too. And squirting water, no sharing water bottles. There should be strict measures, too, because no boxer or anybody in general can afford to get sick. Still, take it easy, man, because my wife said that the cases jumped up at her hospital this week. So, the other day they had 17, now they have like 25, and then they had two kids, now they have three or four kids. So, people are still not staying away from each other.
Well, hopefully everybody gets better. So, what have you been up to, Frank? What have you been watching a lot of boxing?
The ESPN was good, man. Did you catch it?
Yeah, but Kobe's better than Jordan. End the story.
Oh, I didn't watch that. But look at, man. When it comes out to basketball, Kobe is not the greatest. Michael Jordan's not the greatest. I think basketball has each era has its own great people. It's really hard to measure. But if anybody's going to lay name a stake to the claim, it'd probably be Bill Russell. He has 11 world titles.
Let me ask you a question. The top four boxers that would go on the boxing Mount Rushmore, Frank, who are your top four ever?
Top four ever.
Number one, Oscar De La Hoya.
You have to, no.
He's your favorite fighter.
You have to put Muhammad Ali.
Why?
You got to put, he's the face of boxing across the world to just normal people. Normal people know who he is. He did a lot for boxing in general, and he has to be up there. He has to.
Okay.
He has to be.
So Ali
Muhammad Ali would be up there. Probably second, well, Pacquiao probably be up there.
That's a good call. I had Pacquiao in my four, too. He's the only eight division champion in boxing.
He definitely has to be up there. Mayweather De La Hoya, did they really do enough? Yes, they made money, but as far as long, like...
Oscar's a 10-time champion in 6th division. Mayweather's a 50-0 champion 6th division. Of course they did enough to be considered a good...
But if you're going to be on a Mount Rushmore, it's more than what you did outside of boxing than just in boxing. De La Hoya has only been known as a great fighter. Yeah, he is his own promotion company, but it's not a staple. Bob Arum has been doing promotions longer than him, and he's paved the way for all the great fighters.
So you would put Bob Arum, you would put Bob Arum on your Mount Rushmore with Ali and Pacquiao.
I would put Ali, Pacquiao, maybe Sugar Ray Leonard. And it's not, like I say, it's like outside of boxing what you're known for if you're going to go on a Mount Rushmore. And I would probably put Mike Tyson, man, because he's just a bad dude, and people know him as being a bad dude, and he actually inspired a lot of people who were bullied, man. Mike Tyson was an inspiration. Even Eminem said he was an inspiration to him.
So. Who's Eminem? What weight class does he fight at?
Eminem, and he shut up, man. He's a rapper, and he freaking said, he told Mike Tyson on the show that he looked up to Mike Tyson.
Can you name for me 5 Eminem songs?
My daughter can rap you the whole verse. Do you want me to have her rap you the verse?
Yes. Lose Yourself.
Can
you hear? No. Give her the phone, Frank.
Here. Say it. Do it. No, she's...
Okay.
Yes, man, I got all those albums. I bought them on iTunes. I support my artists, man. I buy their music.
Do you know how to rap, Frank?
No, I don't.
Do you know how to sing corridos?
I know how to be an executive producer.
Yes, it's Guerra. Honestly, that could have won you a Grammy, and he could have been on Grammy night right near, like, you know, Michael Jackson and what's the name, R. Kelly. Frank had an artist.
I'm going to shoot it over to Ryan Garcia. I'm going to shoot it over to Ryan Garcia because it has Garcia in it. It only has Mikey Champ, but I could change that champ into Ryan. It's Mike's fault for not, hey, Mike. I think as a marketing plan, it would have been good and coming out with the song, but I see Mikey likes coming out with corridos, so whatever. But I believe that song would have done good for a boxer, man.
Billy Dib or Abner Mares, who wins? They're going to fight, I think.
You know what? Yeah, I was thinking. I saw you posted it about it. And you know what? Off the injury that Abner is coming off, it wouldn't be a bad fight. I mean, of course, Abner freaking annihilates him, but it wouldn't be a bad fight, man. Test out his eye. It's not like Billy Dib has a lot of power, but you would have to watch out for Billy. He likes to cheap shot people. But it wouldn't be a bad fight, man. Just to get Abner a fight back, test out his eye, see if it's going to be able to withhold it. It wouldn't be bad, man. It wouldn't be bad at all. And I bet you, if Abner was to go to Australia, that fight might do some business over there.
So you would recommend Morris to go do it in Melbourne or Sydney?
What?
You would tell Abner to go do it in Australia?
Well, dude, that fight would probably do good because Abner is known as a true Mexican warrior, and showing off his skills in Australia, that'd be awesome, dude. I mean, nobody's going to buy in L.A., nobody's going to want to see a Billy Dib fight in L.A., but if Abner goes to Australia, I bet it can sell.
Would you go?
Dude, come on, man. That's halfway across the world. If I had my ticket paid for and I helped advertise, yeah, I would go.
Let me tell everybody. But, Frank doesn't fly to San Diego. He doesn't fly to Dallas. He doesn't fly to New York. How is he going to fly to Australia, Frank? What, are you going
to
take a boat, a yacht?
Texas, man. I flew to Texas before. I flew before. It's just scary as hell, man. Hey, somebody's in control of your life, man, when you're flying, man.
Somebody's in control of your life when they're in an Uber. So what, you're not going to drive in an Uber?
Yeah, but Uber, you're not falling 36,000 feet to the ground. And
haven't you seen Dumb and Dumber? There's a, what, when he takes the lady to the airport, he says there's a bigger chance of getting in a crash on the streets than in a plane crash.
That was the first movie me and my wife ever saw when we were dating.
Yeah, it's one of the best movies ever. It's a classic.
Dumb and Dumber. That was our first date, 1994, January 1994.
Wow, you were married before. You were dating your wife before I even came to America.
It was December. I mean, it was January 1994.
And what do you remember? Do you remember any lines from the movies?
No, but I remember when they didn't flush the damn toilet, man. Remember he had to go use the bathroom, and then they told him, don't use the bathroom. It doesn't flush. And he's like, oh, shit. You don't remember that part?
Yeah, I do. When he was going skiing with the lady. Yeah, I remember that part. I know that movie by heart. I thought the movie was pretty good.
Yeah, I didn't care for the remake.
No, they weren't as good. Yeah, no.
No.
Have you ever seen the movie? Frank, have you ever seen the movie UHF with Weird Al?
UHF, that was back in the late 80s, no?
Yeah, that's a classic. If no one's seen UHF, go see it. It's pretty funny.
That was a long time ago, man. You remember, where'd you watch it at? In Israel?
Yeah.
Yeah? Did they have was it in Israel? You already knew English in Israel, right?
Yeah, everybody speaks English.
Oh, okay.
All right, let me ask you this, Frank. So, right now, Devin Haney, if he fights Loma, who wins that fight?
Against Loma?
Yeah.
Well, but Sally takes him out, man. I don't know, man, why he would say he wouldn't get beat by no white boy. Hey, even...
Who's Vasali?
Vasal Lomachenko. Hey, how
Vasili,
about...
Vasili.
Hey, how about Devin Haney versus Carl Frampton?
It's a good fight, but Devin Haney's a champion, and I want to see him unify with one of the champs. So with the
How
champs,
about Devin Haney versus Nonito Donaire first?
What do you mean? Haney's 35, Donaire's 118. How could they even make sense, Frank? There was weight classes in boxing. What do you want to see? You want to see Andy Ruiz against...
I forgot.
How about Inouye and Andy Ruiz? Would that be a good fight?
I forgot he went down. You're right. I forgot. Hey, but I know, man. Hey, those words are going to come back to haunt him. But you know what? Good thing it was good and bad because he got a lot of publicity for what he said. And, you know, some boxers need publicity. But, Lomachenko takes him out, man.
Hold on 1 second, Frank. I got to give someone a shout out really quick. Shout out to Maria Guadalupe from Azusa. Have you ever been to Azusa, Frank?
No.
Why not?
Where? You said where?
Azusa, California.
That's up north.
No, it's not. It's in the LA area. Azusa? I think it's...
Azusa.
Yeah. Hey, who here could guess the name of the city that Frank lives at? Don't tell him, Frank. What's the name of Frank's city where he lives at? I'm trying to see if anybody knows.
Hey, shout out to Rich.
No, he's not from Palmdale.
Hey, shout out to Rich Strip, though.
Yeah, that's true. Frank.
He's always watching YouTube.
Frank is from Corona. That's where the virus started, my understanding is, right? That's why they call it the coronavirus.
Hey, that's weird, huh? They're saying that the coronavirus could have been here in California in November.
I don't know.
That's what they're saying, and they're saying that more people in LA have the coronavirus than anticipated. So
okay,
but
Frank,
it's dormant.
Victor Ortiz, shout out to Garden City, Kansas. I see here, Victor Ortiz against Maidana. Who wins the rematch?
That would be awesome. Let's just get it on. Who cares, man? That fight should have had a rematch. I remember watching that fight on my computer back in the day, man, and that fight was an awesome fight, man. I didn't know who they both were, and I was like, what the hell? That was an awesome fight.
What do you mean? They were, well, Maidana wasn't famous yet, but everyone knew Victor. Victor was supposed to be the next Oscar De La Hoya. I remember I covered that fight. Victor was at the time like 23-1, and the one loss that he had was like a technical loss, like punching someone after the bell. But something like that. But he didn't have a loss. And I remember interviewing Victor and Chino before the fight, and no one even recognized Chino. No one gave Chino a chance because it was just him and what's the name of the manager that he had? Sebastian Contursi. And Contursi and Maidana were walking by themselves near Staples Center, and no one gave them even a time of day. And everybody was chasing Victor.
What an awesome fight that was, man. That was a really good fight all the way around. And I think, if I'm not mistaken, Maidana got dropped first, and then Ortiz got dropped, and then didn't Maidana get dropped like 2-3 times, and Ortiz got dropped 3 times, and then they finally stopped the fight?
Yep.
I remember it was back and forth, and damn, that was a classic, man. And that's cool. They both were on Instagram together.
Let me ask you a question. You're a chef. You're a cook. Are you an expert in calories?
In calories? What do you mean? Like, do I know what calories are every vegetable?
No. Like, basically, Robert told me that every fighter should train and get ready because they're coming back soon. So what should fighters eat for the next 3-4 weeks to lose weight?
Just eat a lot of fiber, man. Right now, they don't have to even go on a strict diet, man. Just eat a lot of fiber-rich foods. And if anything, just start cutting back from the grease right now. Calorie count, you can't really say, because some fighters work out 3-4 times a day versus other fighters only work out 2 times a day. Alfredo, the one who was sparring Mikey for the Earl Spence.
Alfredo Angulo.
Alfredo
Escarcica Jr.
Yeah, he worked out a lot, man. Like, he worked out 3-4 times a day. So people like him that burn food need to take more calories, obviously. So they're probably up 2,500 to, 4,200 calories a day, where some fighters only do the run, only do the work, and then that rest of the day, they're just chilling. So they don't need as many calories. Yeah. It depends on how much they work and how fast their metabolism goes.
So the answer is you don't have a clear answer.
There's no clear answer for that. But if they are getting ready, just cut away the fatty foods. No more pizza, no more chicken.
What are they supposed to do, starve? That's all people are eating these days, Frank.
Yeah, I know, man. But boxers, most boxers still live with their parents, dude. So their parents, probably step in and help them out. But, I don't know.
Frank, how come you never wanted to be a boxer? How come you never trained and fought and got into it?
I did, man. I did. My father wasn't like that. And when I was a kid growing up, I had to babysit my brothers and sisters because there was a family of 4, and my mom and dad were at work. I used to be left alone every day till like 8 o'clock at night. And I had to make sure they ate, took care of everybody ever since I was in 6th grade. So I only 1 year I was able to play football my freshman year, but from fifth or sixth grade all the way through senior high school, I had to babysit my brothers and sisters. Man. So
are you high right now?
No, we just got back from eating. I'm gonna eat Pizza Hut.
All right, go eat some pizza, Frank. We'll talk soon. Enjoy your 420.
Thank you.
You always have the munchies, whether you smoke or not. It's very impressive.
Hey, I got some. I got thin crust, light cheese. I got half jalapeno pineapple, extra sauce, and the other half mushroom, olives, and sausage.
All right. Frank loves the sausage. All right, Frank.
All right, Ellie. Reporting. Thanks, man. Have a good night,
You got
Tell
it.
Everybody, I said, what's up? Hey, tell the boxers, man, hey, they want to make money. They want a good game plan. Bring me along as part of their team. Let me talk. Let me help build them teams. I'm telling you, man, I'm ready. I'm ready to unload this knowledge.
All right.
I can get boxers making money, man. That's what the bottom line is, and it's proven. So Frank's, any boxers out there, give me a call.
Frank's ready to, you're ready to drop the load. Drop the load, Frank. All right. I'll let them know. So that was Frank the Cook, just an update. If you guys want to call in, 818-522-0221, 818-522-0221. Frank builds champions. I'm telling you guys, he can have a reality show where he's going to tell celebrities how to live their life and how to be successful. Hello?
Hello, Ellie.
Yeah, how's it going?
How's it going? Great, Ellie. My name is Jose. I actually called in last week, and we had a really good conversation. like about 20 minutes.
What's up, Jose? How are you feeling? You're calling from New York. I remember the accent.
Yes.
You had the COVID-19 virus last time.
I tested positive. I told you that I tested positive for the virus.
Yeah. How are you feeling? Did you beat it yet?
Oh, I'm good. I'm good. I'm out of quarantine. I'm back to work, so I'm feeling good.
Good. What do you do for a living?
I work at a medical liabilities and insurance company.
All right, cool. So what do you want? What's on your mind? Which fight?
The Mount Rushmore.
Okay, who you got? Top four fighters in boxing history.
I would say I'll put Ali, Pacquiao, Mayweather, and Chavez Sr.
Why Chavez?
Because he's a freaking Mexican legend, man. Champ. He still got him. He just beat Keith Thurman, who was a young guy. So
cover of Time Magazine, movies, TV. He's a senator. He's a congressman. All that.
I think he's great, man.
Okay. And who else do you say? Ali? Why Ali?
And out of the ring. He's done a lot.
And then your last one was Floyd.
In my opinion, one of the current Floyd, I mean, he beat Oscar. He beat everybody. I mean, he beat Pacquiao. Who did he beat? So, I mean, you gotta put Floyd up there. It's definitely a GOAT.
All right. And then you have to pick four coaches. Who are the top four best coaches in your opinion in boxing history?
Ooh, see, boxing history, I don't know, man, but I could tell you currently the coaches that I like.
Okay. Top four.
Definitely Robert Garcia is up there.
He had 13 champions between 2010 to 2020.
Nah, man. Robert's great. I think Eddie Reynoso, of course, is up there. And I mean, he probably didn't get the recognition before.
He's made champions years ago. I remember we had 1 year, maybe 4 or 5 years ago, where he had three champs in 1 year and nobody noticed.
So. Yeah, I mean, he's got a lot of good champs.
Okay, Robert, Eddie, who else?
See the ones. The guy just passed away. Roger Mayweather.
Roger was a great. Never got recognition ever. No one ever recognized him. But obviously, great coach.
He was a great trainer.
What about Nacho?
Nacho Bernstein is great. I like Nacho.
He's had 25 champions. And then Emmanuel Stewart. Emmanuel Stewart was great. He knew how to take people from zero and make them world champs, which is very hard to do.
Yeah.
I mean, Robert Garcia has done that. Joe Goosen is a great trainer. Everybody just talked about the fight Castillo Corrales last week. It re-aired on Showtime.
Yeah. Hey, Ellie, I wanted to ask you a question. Because like I said, I follow your channel. I always follow your lives when you go on the when you're in the gym.
Yeah.
Now, one thing that I when I was watching the Carlos Adames fight versus Patrick. To share his last fight.
Yeah.
I noticed that, like, Adames' legs were just gone after a few rounds. So I wanted to ask, like, do you know if he's changed the way that he's training? Is he doing more cardio? Is he running more? Because, I mean, I don't know if it was... I mean, in my opinion, he was landing the cleaner shots. He was landing, like, the bigger punches. But it seemed like his legs were just not under him.
It definitely wasn't. I mean, it was a winnable fight and a fight that I thought he was gonna win. Wasn't his night that night. The cards were a little wide, but if I'm not mistaken, it was a very, very close fight.
I mean, I think it was a very close fight. I think it could have gone either way. But I just feel like watching the fight, his legs were gone after a few rounds.
Yeah, and sometimes it has to do with lifestyle. Sometimes it has to do with like. Coming into camp in shape, do you know what I mean?
Yeah, I understand.
So hopefully, look, he's back in the gym. They just all went back to the Dominican Republic this week, actually, because they were stuck here. There were no flights. But
they weren't able to go back?
No, they weren't able to go back. There were like four of them in the gym. I was Jackson, Adames, and two other... Huh?
No, Marinas is there.
Yeah.
No, Marinas is there.
And there's another kid named Garcia. Adames and they couldn't go back, and now they finally went back. But Adames was taking his training very seriously. He was working, and the only thing is, it was funny because he came back to the gym with no mouthpiece, and he was sparring full sparring with no mouthpiece.
Yeah, I actually saw that. I was like,
Carlos, what are you doing? You know, I mean, someone could land a punch, you could lose all your teeth. He's like, no, it's going to make me better defensive. I'm going to move my head more because I know I don't want to get hit. But I told him to go to big five or...
I understand what he's saying. Like, okay, because if I get hit, I might get knocked out. But the problem is that I think that if let's say somebody catches him with a good hook or a clean punch to the jaw, you know, he may never be the same. Because some fighters that get knocked out like that, if he gets knocked out like that, let's say in sparring, we're not wearing a mouthpiece. You know, fighters I've seen in history that have gotten knocked out like that, you know, their chin is like a light switch and they get tagged and they get, you know.
Unfortunately, that's how boxing is. It gets worse with time. But I wanted to ask you, who are the top four greatest broadcasters in boxing? Like, who do the best job right now? Obviously, HBO's out of the business. So I guess it's Showtime, DAZN, and ESPN are the categories. And I have a...
Networks or like individual?
No, individual. Let's say Paulie Malignaggi, I think, does a great job, right?
I don't really like Paulie too
much. You don't like Paulie? Why not?
You know what it is? He seems to be a little bit biased towards some fighters, and he just, I don't know. He's a little biased.
You're one of the few people who tell me you don't like him, but I see in the comments other people. But then again, you know, like, I think he does a good job, but... who else do you got? So Paulie's one, but he's not your type. He's not your flavor.
He's not here. I mean, listen. I mean, yeah, Paulie's okay. It's just, I think with me, it's just he's trashed some fighters, and he's, I don't know, but...
That's how I used to feel, to be honest with you, about HBO boxing. I felt that if they didn't like a fighter, they would trash the hell out of them.
but that's why HBO went out of business. That's why they went out of boxing business, because they were biased. They put all their... They invested a lot into certain fighters, and then they built up these fighters to be something they're not. And then when those fighters got knocked out, then it was like, you know, then it was like, oh, what do we do? So, you know, but I like Roy Jones. I think Roy Jones is very good.
Well, he's not on the air anymore, but yeah, he is good.
Well, Roy Jones was very good when he was you know, when he was broadcasting. I think Andre Ward has done a really good job.
Let's see, who else?
Well, let's see. I think
you have Joe Goosen on Fox. He's very good.
You know, like I said, I think Joe Goosen is very good. I like Andre Ward. You know, like, Paulie's okay. I mean, I don't know. I just don't like the way that he was trashing Wilder when Wilder was fighting on Showtime. And, you know, he's trashed Canelo a few times. You know, that's, I think those are, like, I don't know. I guess I'm a little biased against him because of that. But I think Paulie over, he's pretty good.
I didn't like, people are commenting that they love the HBO crew. I didn't like nothing about HBO broadcasting because let me explain to them why really quick.
They were the most biased commentators in the sport.
If there were two fighters fighting on HBO and one was signed to HBO and one wasn't, they would totally ignore anything that the guy that wasn't signed to HBO would do. Even if he would land 10 punches in a row, they would downplay it. While the HBO fighter, if he would even throw and miss, they would have said, oh my God, what a tremendous throw. Like, they would overhype him.
I agree with you 100%.
Yeah, and I didn't like that. And then...
But like I said, Roy Jones was fair, though.
Yeah, no, he was fair. Emmanuel Stewart, when he was there, he was fair.
Emmanuel Stewart was very good.
Emmanuel Stewart used to complain to me that he didn't like how he was treated.
I mean, like I said, I think Roy Jones was there was very good because he kind of kept people in line. It was like, you know, but like I said, I like Andre Ward. I think he's very fair. He obviously knows boxing, you know, better than anyone else that sits alongside of him.
Well, he's a former fighter, and that helps a lot. One thing that I was always tripping about, that HBO, in boxing, we all know it's heavy Latino, whether it's Mexican, Puerto Rican, South America, Central America, but they didn't have one broadcaster on the air that spoke Spanish, not even one. And I thought that was the weirdest thing. With everybody in boxing that's a trainer, a former fighter, you couldn't find one to put on your broadcast crew?
But another thing that I noticed is that a lot of times, you know, for example, some have the interpreter. Was it Felix de Jesus, I think is his name?
Yeah, but he was terrible, man. No disrespect to the guy, maybe a sweetheart of a human being, but his Spanish wasn't that good.
No, but that's what I'm saying, like, they, that's one guy that I remember. But a guy that does a very good job interpreting, which, like I said, I'm Dominican. I speak Spanish. So I'm fluent. But one of the guys that does a great job interpreting is the guy that usually does interpretations for Canelo. He's like a, you know, kind of light skinned short guy with glasses. He usually does the interpretation for Canelo.
Yeah, no, but I was referring to on air broadcast. You know, they have like former fighters that come in and be part of the analysts.
Yes.
How come HBO in all the years of boxing never found a Mexican American, Latino, Puerto Rican American, someone that's bilingual? That could listen to the corner, that knows the sport. I was saying, I noticed it stood out to me that HBO never had a Spanish speaking guy on the panel.
HBO was catering to a different crowd. They were catering more to the Eastern Europeans. Like they, if you notice that when Gennady Golovkin was HBO, they were behind him like full force. And then there were, you know, what is it, when Kovalev was also there too. And they weren't really giving, Andre Ward, the respect that he deserved. So I just, like I said, I feel like they were just catering to a different crowd, and that's probably why.
Yeah, it could be. Or I had a theory because the dollar ratio to the dollar to the coin in their country is like 1 to 30, 1 to 40, 1 to 50. So having Eastern European fighters or former Soviet Union fighters, and you pay them $300,000 back home at $6 million versus an American fighter, you pay him $300,000, they'd rather go somewhere else.
Yeah, true. That could be.
No, for sure. Okay, so my last question is, top four young fighters that will be champions for sure, that are not champions now.
Well, shit, this is a tough one.
Virgil Ortiz.
Well, Virgil, I will say number one. He's definitely going to be a champion. Within the next, you know, he's two fights away from a title shot. But he's definitely going to be a champion. Virgil Ortiz, I think Ryan Garcia will be a champion. I don't know when, but he'll be a champion.
Okay, that's two.
Shakur Stevens is already a champ.
Yeah, he's a champ. He beat the, what did he beat? His girlfriend's brother, right?
Yeah.
I forgot the guy's name.
What is it? Joet?
Joet Gonzalez.
Gonzalez, Joel Gonzalez, yeah. So he's already a champion.
Little B-Hop, Chris Colbert. I think he'll be champ for sure.
Lil.
The kid from New York, Chris Colbert. His name is Primetime now. He changed his nickname.
Yes. He's from Brooklyn. He's fun to watch. He's fun to watch. I like watching him.
Lindolfo could be 11-0, 11 knockouts. Lindolfo Delgado.
Yeah, Lindolfo Delgado, he trained with Robert, right?
Yeah, he's one of the few fighters. I asked Robert Garcia. I interviewed Robert today, and I posted those videos. I asked Robert, out of your 35 fighters that you coach, pro fighters, tell me the four that are in the best shape. He said Virgil, Lindolfo, Jose Ramirez.
Yeah, because those guys are freaking workhorses, man. Those guys don't stop.
That's true. So, all right, one more name. Who do you think it is? The fourth one. Hold on. There's Rowley's, who's 10-0, 11 knockouts.
Listen, Rowley's a problem, and people are sleeping on Rowley. Rowley is going to be a problem for anyone at any weight division because that kid is mean. He likes to fight. He likes to knock people out. I like Rowley. There's also that Puerto Rican kid out of New York, Josue Vargas.
Yeah, Jose. I don't know. Right? If you go to his Instagram, he's doing his homemade casino right now. He's giving away money. You have to send him money, and then he puts a raffle, and the winners get paid.
Are you serious?
Yeah. I didn't want to put him on blast, so I didn't share those videos. But Josue, he's creative.
Because New York, man, though, for the cops will freaking show up at your house and the FBI. And
Hopefully not.
But yeah, I think Josue Vargas, I think he'll be a champ.
Yeah, he turned pro at 17. He was signed with Floyd Mayweather. Obviously, now he's with Top Rank, and he definitely has a lot of potential. Yeah. And then there was a question here on the live a few minutes ago. Someone asked, what did it feel like to have the COVID-19 virus?
I mean, for me, like I said, for me, I didn't have many symptoms. So this is how I went. Friday, I was home. Saturday and Sunday, I woke up, and my nose was starting to itch. And okay, I don't know if you guys have ever smelled like straight up bleach and it starts to burn your nose. That's how it started to feel like the first few days. Like bleach is like burning your nose. I mean, not the smell, but the feeling in the nose. So then after that, I was congested, and like I said, I never had allergies before, so it was kind of weird. And then the day that I knew something was wrong was I lost my sense of smell for a day, which was like, you know, at my job, they put mulch out in the lawn like once a year, and that's a very strong smell. You know, it's fertilizer, so it smells really strong. And when I got out the car, I didn't smell absolutely nothing. And that's when I knew, I was like, all right, I have to get checked because this is weird. And then after that, because of the nasal congestion for the few days, I was getting a little headaches. But then after that, I was fine. I really didn't have any of the big symptoms, like the really bad symptoms that people were getting. That was just my experience. Everybody gets it differently. So, but like I said, I've heard of people that I know some other people that had it, that, you know, they get really high fevers, you know, 105 fevers. They get chills, their bone hurts.
But let me ask you this. Did you take any medication at all or just pass naturally?
No, I think when I called you last time, all I did was, like, as soon as I felt kind of funny, I started doing that gargle that I mentioned.
With the lemon, right?
Yeah, the gargle is just salt water. I put baking soda in it, a little bit of vinegar, and fresh squeezed lime juice. And I did that, like, multiple times a day. I was doing it multiple times a day, and I just kept doing it. And that's all I was doing.
And it worked. Well, I'm glad you're doing better. Stay safe, stay healthy, be careful. And I think the big news is by the end of May, the beginning of June, boxing will be back.
Man, I sure hope so, man. I'm excited for the Teofimo and Lomachenko fight. Hopefully Loma don't back out.
Yeah, well, hopefully that fight happens. And there you have it. Stay tuned. But thanks so much for the call and stay well.
Thank you so much.
You got it. You too. Hello? We're getting a lot of calls here. If you guys want to call in, 818. Someone asked, where's Delilah? So she's in the closet. That's her latest trick right now. I guess it's cool in there. 818-522-0221. 818-522. Hello? Hello?
Hello. Is it going early?
Good. How are you?
I'm doing great. This is Jesus and Zion Medina calling in to check up on the other fighters.
Everything's good. How are you feeling?
I'm feeling great. I'm actually working out while you're listening to your guys' calls.
That's cool. That's cool. You're working out on 420. That's badass.
Oh, yeah. Almost daily. Yeah.
Almost daily. So what was I going to say? It's just interesting. But let me ask you this. Who do you think are the four greatest fighters in the history of boxing?
Well, it's difficult to put it that way, but if we would cut it up into at least three different categories, say, for instance, classics, 70s to 2000, and then current classics, I would say Jack Dempsey, Charlie Burley, what's his name, Muhammad Ali, and then I would say, no, Bam Bam is actually... beyond 70s, because Bam Bam, I think, is one of the best ones as well. Bam Bam Mancino, do you guys remember that?
Yeah.
Mancini.
He was from Youngstown, Ohio, and unfortunately, he killed a guy in a ring, and that's when they changed it from 15 rounds to 12 rounds.
Yeah, against the Korean, right?
Yes. Kuk-su won, I think.
Yeah, that was a phenomenal fight. Yeah, that's crazy. And that was for money, man. That was, you know, I mean, I'm sure you watched that fight plenty of times, and you can tell his eyes weren't there the whole time. His fucking warrior spirit is the only thing that kept him up.
Yeah, but Mancini, he's a broadcaster on Fox. He wrote a book. He actually got mad at me the other day.
What?
Because, no, it's cool. No, not like that. We're still cool. Because yeah. Kelly Pavlik, who's from the same city like him, told me something on my video, like, who did Mancini fight? And I just stayed quiet, and Mancini was mad at me that I didn't defend him. But usually I always, like, defend, but it's just like, yeah, you know, it happens.
Yeah, how about Salvador Sanchez? Yeah, he died early. But
22 in a car crash, very tragic, yeah, and he was fighter of the year, and what was it? What year was it? 1983? Or...
No, way before that. It was like I would say maybe 77, 78, somewhere around there.
Let's look. Salvador
Sanchez.
Sanchez. If I remember, it was 82, 83, but let's see. You may be right. Yeah. He was world champion 80 and 82.
Oh, okay, okay, yeah, all right. Yeah, and then what is it? For 70s and on and up, I would say, what's his name? Goodness. I was in Iraq, so it's hard for me to remember because I was blown up many times. So, goodness, what's his name? Oh, goodness. I can't even remember names right now. Ask me a question.
Okay, it's all good, it's all good. All right, man, but thank you so much for the call, man. I appreciate it.
Real quick, I want to mention something about the Snow Queen, the show you featured. She was actually phenomenal.
All right.
Like she's going to come up really, like, really good. I think she's going to get picked up by somebody because she actually did a great job. She kept her cool, everything, and that was great that you featured that. Thank you for doing that.
Of course. Yeah, no, you're welcome. Over. All right.
Perfect. Oh, last thing real quick about the mouthpiece. Please, boxers, train with your mouthpiece in, because if you don't train with your mouthpiece in, it makes a huge difference when you're in the fight. Just clenching the mouthpiece alone, you use more than 22 muscles. Do the math. You want to train without it and fight with it. It's going to be a whole different situation. You're going to get tired a lot quicker, and it makes a huge difference when you're in a championship a fight.
That's true. No, I agree. In every sport, because some people are just not used to wearing like an ankle brace or a knee brace or a mouthpiece. And then when you put it on, you're not comfortable.
Yeah, and that's the whole point. Your body will adapt to everything it consistently is exposed to. And I mean, I haven't done a single ab crunch or sit-up since 2006, and I have a 12-pack, not a fucking 6-pack, not an 8-pack, not a 10-pack, a 12-pack, thanks to what? The mouthpiece, because it is difficult to breathe. So what happens? You use your diaphragm, not just your lungs, and you have to use your nose to breathe. If you're breathing with your mouth, you're not breathing in much oxygen.
Yeah. Well, thank you so much for the call. I appreciate it. Good knowledge. Thank you.
Most definitely. Have a good
one. All right. Thanks. Peace. You too. Hello? Hello?
What's up, Eli?
I'm good. Who am I speaking with?
This is Rafael, man, over here in Chula Vista.
What's up, Rafael?
Ah, man, just out here listening to your show, man.
What do you think? So far, so good?
So far, so good, man. You got a lot of fans down here, man. Chula Vista.
That's cool. That's right by San Diego. That's where Canelo trains, right?
We're right by the border, bro.
I like Tijuana. Shout out to TJ.
That's right.
So someone are telling me, someone wrote here, and I don't know if it's a joke or not, that Teofimo Lopez Loma is not going to happen. I think it's going to happen.
You know what? Shoot. I think it will happen, man. Honestly, I think Teofimo is probably the future, man. I think he's gonna upset Loma.
Yeah, it could be. It's a 50-50 fight. Teofimo has the game-changing power. Lomachenko's a great boxer, but he's in the smaller weight classes. Obviously, 135 is a little big for him, and Teofimo's right. A big 135. So we will have to see.
Yeah, you know what? I think people. Thanks, I mean, I don't know. I mean, I'm not really a big Lomachenko fan. I mean, I respect what he.
Big word. I respect very sick.
How he fights. I mean, but I think Teofimo's. He's like an up and comer, you know, and he's
a champ. Teofimo's a champion, and he earned that belt. He wasn't given. He had a sensational knockout against Richard Comey. So it's a very interesting fight. And then you have the psychological aspect where Teofimo's been chasing the Loma fight for 3 years. And I was there in New York when Teofimo's dad had a run-in with Loma.
So. Right. Yeah. Like I said, he's been calling him out for a while. So I think Teofimo's hungry and he's younger. He's fast. And he's, I think he's probably going to upset him. I mean, that's what I'm thinking. You know, I know everybody likes Loma and everything, but I think Teofimo is probably going to beat him. I think he pulls out the upset.
All right. Who's your favorite fighter, by the way?
That's what I was going to call you, man. I've been dying to try to get through, man, because I'm like getting tired of everybody just not putting Canelo on the number one pound for pound. I mean, honestly, I know that there's Loma up there and Crawford, But Canelo has the bigger names, the bigger fights, and he's taking the bigger risks.
I got Canelo up there.
Huh?
I got Canelo as number one.
You have Canelo as number one?
Yeah.
Yeah, but I mean, I see like your videos or other, you know, other videos where people constantly get asked, and it's always in me. And even the A Los Golpes, the ESPN Mexican show, and they constantly ask fighters who they think is the number one pound for pound, and they always either go with Loma or Crawford. And honestly, I think Canelo's better. I mean, I think Canelo has done more, has proven more than both of those guys.
Canelo's only 29. He has a bright future. And he's a four division champ. And let's see if I think he's going to end up being a 5 and 6, 7 division champ in the end of the day. Because
Yeah, he just keeps getting better. And he obviously, he doesn't get the respect that other people, I mean, there's a lot of Canelo haters out there, but I think he's great. I think he might even end up doing. I mean, he's already done more than Chavez Sr. I mean, that's what I'm thinking.
That's what Robert Garcia was saying. No boxing, no life.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. I just wanted to get it out there, man. I mean, I think Canelo's one of the he's going to probably be one of the greatest Mexican champions ever.
I agree with you. And then what do you think about, last thing I'm going to ask you, Andy Ruiz looks like he's going to train with Eddie Reynoso.
Yeah, I think that's a good idea for him. I mean, from what I watched videos and everything. I mean, I've seen that his ex-trainer was saying that he wasn't training, right, and whatever. But, yeah, I think, honestly, if he goes to the right camp, I think he could do more. And he obviously was missing a lot of things when he fought Joshua. But if he goes to Eddie, I think he's going to get better. And he could probably beat. You know what I would like to see? Who I would like to see him fight against? I would like to see him fight against Wilder.
That would be a big fight. But hopefully Wilder beats Fury, and then that fight can happen.
Yeah. You know what? Even if Wilder loses to Fury, I would still like to see Wilder versus Andy, because they're going to go at it. There's not going to be no one's going to back down. And that's going to be a good fight.
Yeah. Well, perfect. Well, thank you so much for the call. I appreciate it.
Thank you, man. Thank you for answering, and thank you for having me, man.
Thank you. Thank you. Always. If you guys want to call, I'm going to take a few more phone calls. My battery's dying. I'm down to 19%. 818-522-0221. 818-522-0221. If you guys want to call in, take a couple more calls, see what's on people's minds. Heavyweight division is doing great, Paul. I don't know. Why would you say that it sucks? Heavyweight division is on fire. You have Andy Ruiz. You have Wilder. You have Joshua. You have Joseph Parker. You have Fury. Hello?
Hey, what's up, Ellie?
I'm good. Who am I speaking with?
Droopy.
Droopy, where are you calling from?
Last name, Nutsack.
Where are you calling from, Droopy?
I just wanted to know, what's...
Droopy Nutsack. Hello? Hello? People calling and not talking. It's not that I look stoned. I haven't slept in a couple of days. I've been very, very busy. I'm helping a TV station here in LA, and it's a lot of hours. But I'll be back at the station tomorrow morning at 10 a.m. Hold on. I hung up on a guy by mistake. Let me call him back. Hello? Hello? If you guys want to call in, 818-522-0221. 818-522-0221. Go to sleep. We got videos to upload. Hello? Hello? Yeah, I'm married. Hello?
Hello?
How's it going?
Hey, what's up, man? How's it going?
Good, how are you?
Good, I was just wondering, what do you who do you think Mikey should fight next?
Pacquiao. And if Pacquiao? Then Crawford. Mikey just wants big fights. Maybe a Spence rematch. Danny Garcia would be great. A Thurman fight. There's a lot of big fights for Mikey.
I think I'd like to see him in there with Danny Garcia. I think that'd be a good fight.
That'd be a very big fight.
Because, you know, Danny Garcia has a couple losses, and, you know, Mike Garcia is coming off a loss, I think.
No, Mikey's coming off a win.
I mean, Mikey's coming off a win, yeah, against Vargas.
Yeah. So, yeah, no, it's good. Listen.
That was a solid win. That was a solid win.
And Danny's coming off a couple wins. He just beat Redcatch.
Yeah.
Did Redcatch ever get paid? Because they were holding his purse for biting Danny on the shoulder.
You know what? I seen that, and I didn't see it till after, and I'd seen it. And I said, man, he really, you know, took a bite in his shoulder.
That's messed up. But then again, hey.
What about Canelo? Who do you want to see him in there with?
I would like to see him fight Benavidez. I'd like to see him fight Demetrius Andre, Charlo. Billy Joe Saunders wouldn't be bad. Colin Smith.
The rumors are saying Triple G in September.
It's possible. But I think Canelo wins that one. And why not? The first two were good fights. But the third one, I think Triple G may be slowing down a little bit. And
yeah.
Canelo's just looking phenomenal.
He's getting older in age, but I think that Canelo maybe even might knock him out this time.
Yeah, but you have to. Boxing is also a business, and Triple G is a recognizable name, and people will tune in. If you told me right now Canelo and Triple G are fighting, I'd watch it.
Yeah, especially the third fight. Yeah, the trilogy.
Yeah, but Canelo really wins this one, no question.
All right, Ali.
Well, thank you so much for the call. I appreciate it.
Yeah. All right, and I was going to tell you, I met you at Mayweather, McDonough, and MGM Grand like years ago. The second fight.
That was the fight where Mayweather said that Maidana bit him, right?
Yeah, that one.
Yeah, and then it was Mayweather won, obviously, but it was a good event. It was a good fight.
2014, I think it was.
6 years ago.
Yeah, I met you over there. But yeah, nice talking to you, though, man. Take
for
care.
Sure. All right, you got it.
All right.
818-522-0221. 818-522-0221. Hello?
Hello?
How's it going?
Good, Ellie. How are you doing?
Pretty good. Can't complain.
Yeah. I'm kind of missing boxing, but can't wait till it gets back.
Well, it's going to be back. Check this out. End of May, early June, boxing will be back.
No fans, right?
No fans, but you'll get to watch it on TV or get to watch it on your phone.
So, will all the boxing big fights, there will be no fans either?
At this point, no. Even if they have fans, I'm thinking they're going to check their temperature in the entrance. Each fan will be sitting like 6 feet or 12 feet from another fan. You know what I mean? It's not going to be like we were used to.
So, Canelo fights this year in September against somebody, it's going to be no fans or
maybe like open that. Maybe open stadium in Vegas, and maybe it's going to be spread out like one fan per three seats or four seats. I don't know. Or maybe no fans. Look, when 9/11 happened, afterwards, no shoes in the airport, no water on a plane. You know how like everything, we went through a lot of changes, right?
Yep.
So we're going to go through a lot of changes when this is over. We'll all have to wear masks. We'll all have to wear gloves. We'll all have our temperature taken, and I think boxing will, sports will be different. Like soccer teams or NBA teams or whoever, football teams, probably no fans at this time until they figure it out.
Until they have the medicine or whatever?
The medicine, but then again, these people are so paranoid and nobody wants to get sued. America's like the champion for lawsuits, right? What if you go to a game and you get sick over there and then you sue the team?
But I mean, if they have the medicine, I mean, you get cured fast. I mean,
yes, but we're all different. Every person's different. So the medicine, you know, I mean, is it guaranteed to work on everybody?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, okay. I'm just saying. Listen, they'll be boxing back, but probably not with live fans.
Nah, it's gonna suck.
Yeah, but it'll be good for the fighters.
Yeah, I mean, they're going to make their money and hopefully stay active like they should be.
Yeah, I'm also hearing the viruses can survive in heat. That's what I'm told. I'm not a scientist or a doctor, so maybe when the weather really gets hot, you know, it's going to help with it.
Has there been any studies yet on the heat and all that? That it has survived in the heat?
Well, so far they say it has survived in the warm countries, but again, it's not the heat of summer that we're used to. Like, where do you live? You're in California, right?
Yeah.
How in Modesto, no?
Yeah.
How hot does it get there in the summer?
Like 100.
So let's see if this thing can survive in 100 degree temperature.
Well, right now in Africa, is it surviving in Africa?
Supposedly it's surviving everywhere. It's in 150 countries, but again, we don't know if people brought it in, got it in a certain way. I don't know.
And what do you think about maybe David Benavides versus Charlo?
Charlo will have to move up to 168. Benavides is a big 68. And he's only 22, so he's growing, and he'll move on to, like, maybe light heavyweight or maybe even cruiserweight at some point. Charlo fights at 54, one Charlo fights at 60. They're very talented, extremely, they're champions. But for Benavides, that means they'll have to move up in weight.
Yeah, but they're a big 160.
Yeah, but in boxing, you wanna beat a big guy. You don't want to give up an advantage. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
I mean, Benavides is a monster. Don't get me wrong. I think it's safe to say David Benavides, in a year or two, most avoided boxer in boxing. No one's going to want to fight him.
Yeah, hopefully he's better. He needs more work on his head movement and body work.
No, he's improving. He's only 22. He's only 22. Give him time. You know, most people only turn pro at 22. He's already a two-time champion.
But I just don't want them to be comfortable with, you know, what they're doing, and then not improve more.
Yeah. No. He's always working. He's a workhorse.
Yeah. So, I want to see him against Carlos Berlinga, Berlinga guy.
Yeah, no, he has a lot of big fights. The big fight we want to see is David Benavides, Caleb Plant. That's the big fight. Champ versus champ. And Benavides recently did an interview, and he said Caleb Champ is the weakest champ in the division.
Yeah, he's got to cut off the ring against him because Plant's going to be moving around and, you know, sleeping a lot. And so
yeah, but it is, and the beef is real. They really don't like each other. So
yeah, he can't let the emotions get to him.
That's true. So we'll see.
And then the other fights I want to see is Teofimo versus Loma.
Who you got in that one?
I don't know, man. It's tough.
Okay, 50-50, let's see. How about Gervonta Tank Davis, Leo Santa Cruz, who wins?
I think Leo can get it because he throws a lot of punches and he's accurate.
Leo's a punching machine. He's like the Energizer Bunny, but Tank has what's called a... What do you call someone that has a game changer, that power? If Tank lands, it's a game changer.
Yeah, Leo's got a good chin, though, and his defense is underrated.
Yeah, but you also have, again, back to the weight classes. Tank fights at 130, 135, but he's big. He's very big for the weight. Leo fights 122, 126, moves up to 130. Tall. Huh?
Leo's pretty tall and he's pretty lanky.
He is tall, but again, he's a 126-pounder. That's where he did his best work. You know what I mean? Yeah. Well, actually, he's a four-division champ, so he was 118, 122, 126, and 130.
But it's all about, you know, if you want to get better and move on to better things, go on to other weight.
Yeah.
If you want to.
Well, it's a very good fight. I'm interested in seeing that one. I want to see what happens. Gervonta Davis, Leo, because Leo is a warrior. He only has one loss to Frampton, and that wasn't a great fight. He never got stopped.
So if that fight happens this year, it's going to be no fans, like you say?
Unfortunately, yeah, because right now, I'll just be happy as step one to get boxing back. So instead of just talking about these hypothetical fights, I could go live and say, did you guys see that fight? What do you think about what you just saw? Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Fans... Okay, let me ask you this. How many fights a year do you go to?
Maybe like two or three.
So, okay. You know, I mean, there's almost no fan that goes to all the fights. And, yeah, it's not going to be the same, but, you know, it'd still be a good fight. It's a good fight. And Dana White has this old saying that if you're in a street corner and one corner they're playing basketball, the other corner they're playing baseball, one corner is soccer, and one corner is a fight, everyone's going to watch the fight. So you're going to watch it whether they have fans there or not, as long as it's a good fight.
Yeah, but it's nothing different. I mean, it's better being live than...
No, no, of course. That's why everyone loves boxing. When you go to a live event, the energy is like, no, I've covered every sport possible. There's no atmosphere like boxing.
Yeah.
So we'll see. But anyways, man, thanks so much for the call. I appreciate it.
All right, thank you.
Thanks. Down to 17% on the phone. I'll take a couple more calls, and we're going to call it a day. 818-522-0221. 818-522-0221. If you guys want to call in. Okay, I want to share with you something that Devin Haney just posted a few minutes ago. This is from Devin Haney. He says the following. Over the past couple of days, I've had time to reflect on a lot. I sincerely regret using a term that I have. I have now learned to be derogatory to many people. I'll continue reading the statement afterwards. Hello?
Elie, what's up, man? This is Darren from Berkeley.
What's up, Darren from Berkeley? How you feeling? You go to school there?
No. I'm too old for that now.
Nice. Never too old to go to school. Listen, never too old to learn something. Especially everybody stuck at home right now. I hope they did something to learn something.
Yeah. No, I came out here because I was in the Coast Guard.
Nice.
Station out here, yeah. So, anyway, I wanted to ask you, man, who do you think in boxing that would be able to fare well, you know, in, say, like a special event like with Conor McGregor?
Which fighter?
Yeah, like which boxer? Like, you think Canelo could do some MMA rounds with somebody like McGregor, or
you want to see people going to McGregor in a cage? That's my understanding. In a boxing ring, anybody's a good fight. He could fight Ryan Garcia. He could fight Gervonta Davis. He could fight Manny Pacquiao. He could fight Mikey. He could fight Mayweather again. He could fight Canelo, and they'll all sell because McGregor's an entertainer and he knows how to make people watch. But in a cage, realistically, let me think. Who has wrestling background in boxing? Sean Porter, I think, would do okay just because his style. I know John Molina his whole life did wrestling, but he's retired now. Any boxers, anybody do you know? Rollies, you know Rolando Romero? Rollies, 11-0, 10 knockouts?
No, I'm not.
Okay, he fights with Mayweather promotion. He has the same personality like Conor. He's very a big personality. His whole life, Rollies did judo. And now he transitioned to boxing, and he's 11-0 with 10 knockouts. So I think Rollies and McGregor, but Rollies, you know, needs a couple more years, and when he's a real household name, he's getting famous, but when he get, that'll be a big fight.
Yeah, no, I'm gonna look that guy up, Rollies, because I'm a judo guy.
Look, Rolando Romero, look him up right now, and on Instagram, he calls himself, let me look at his IG, I'll show you. Are you watching the screen right now? This is what his IG looks like.
No, I can't see the screen
right okay, now. His sister is also like a judoka, how do you say it, judoka? So that's his page, Rollies. He has 108,000 followers. He's very popular. He'll be making a lot of noise in boxing. Let me see if I can find a picture of him as a, in judo. I'll show you guys really quick. He speaks Spanish. He speaks English.
Man, you should try to get him to think about doing something like that, you know?
Yeah, but he's pursuing boxing right now. He's trying to do the best he can in the boxing ring.
Sure.
He's half Cuban, half African American. He's a very, very talented athlete.
Yeah, I'm gonna check him out, man. Thanks, man. I'm glad you're still doing stuff, man. And you know, I wanted to tell you, I like watching your videos, especially when you had a lot of stuff with Jose Aldo in the gym.
Yeah, you know? Shout out to Jose. He always sends me stuff on the IG. He's a good dude, man. He's really a good human being.
Yeah, I mean, it was nice to see, you know, footage of an MMA guy in a boxing gym, you know. That was just awesome. I really like that. I really like the question.
I'm going to tell you what's interesting with Aldo. We were messing around in the gym. Just messing around, you know, hey, like, show me. He did, like, 3 submissions in 30 seconds. He did an arm bar, he choked me out, and I don't know what else, he turned me into a pretzel.
Yeah.
Very talented, and he has amazing kicks.
Yeah,
For sure, man. Yeah. But thanks so much for the call.
Yeah, for sure, man. Keep doing what you do, man. We love it, man.
Thanks. Appreciate it. All right, guys. A couple more and we're going to call it a day here. Aaron DeLeon says, Ellie, my mom yells at me sometimes because I have my notification on and your videos on my phone blows up because of your videos you put every day. Well, that's good. Usually I get wives, girlfriends mad, moms mad. But at least you're up on your boxing knowledge. You're up on your boxing, what's going on in the boxing world. Hello? I don't know. Something's wrong with that guy's phone. He keeps calling and hanging up. Oh, sad day. My condolences to Tony Harrison. His coach passed away today. Hello? Hello?
Ellie.
Yeah.
I had a call back about that mixed martial arts against boxing. It's a whole different ballgame.
Yeah, no. But he wanted to see which boxer could do good in a cage. So I'm thinking it has to be a boxer with a martial arts background.
Yeah, that's the only way that actually conditions their legs. Because just one kick to the leg, I mean, I'm a huge Canelo fan before he was even mainstream.
Yeah.
And one kick to the leg will slow him way the fuck down because he's naked in boxing.
No, he's from Milwaukee, by the way. Anthony Perez trains in Vegas. Good dude, him and his brother. I've watched them both fight. I was there when Nate Diaz fought Anthony Perez. He called him the weedy box guy.
But I actually got to fight a actual boxing fight exhibition fight.
Mm-hmm.
I got to fight an exhibition fight against another boxer in a cage, and it was a very interesting situation because when you're knocking someone out, the way they fall, they don't expect to fucking hit the cage the way my opponent did.
It's a different sport. It's a different set of skills. Listen, if you want to survive in a fight, just survive in a street fight. Go learn Krav Maga because that's about street. That's not. That's taking.
Yeah, especially right now. Okay, let boxing come back. But since there's no like we keep saying that there's not going to be any spectators and all this. Well, what if there's no money involved overall? But it's up to the fucking boxer to do their networking, and then whatever fans they get, that's the money. They I know it sounds weird, but that'll be the best way because that will make boxers smart entrepreneurs. I mean, I'm sorry, but there's some great boxers out there that are idiots when they speak. They have nothing to say, and all they say is, "Oh, I'm from the streets, and I, this is just the way I talk, and what's up, nigga, and this and that." And sometimes not even a black dude, and I'm like, "What? Wait, why would you use that word? Period. But the point is I don't know if you noticed, some boxers, I mean, have no mouthpiece, in other words, just to speak. But, I mean, I honestly think there should be more regulations, if you may, to make warriors actual warriors, not just someone that will fight, train and fight, and that's it. If there's no money involved, I guarantee you, more than half of the fighters on these that you all love wouldn't even fight. Because they don't have the time to get it. There's no money involved. They have children to take care of. They have school to go to, whatever it is. So I just want more people to be in it for the love of the game in all reality.
Yeah,
and
but
there'll be better matches, actually. In all reality, there'll be better matches because it would be less injuries. And it would be more honorable, just like real martial arts are. When you're done with martial arts, they fucking, it's full respect.
Yeah.
I'm not saying it's not like that in boxing, but.
But it's just different because boxers need to get paid. You can't do this for free. Nobody wants to get beat up or, it's put your life on the line for free. I'm sorry. It doesn't work like that. And it's hard to tell a fighter, generate your own following. They're busy training. You know what I mean? Very few fighters could do a Ryan Garcia. That's why you got to respect Ryan. Look how big Ryan Garcia got. And he's still fighting and training. When you train and you 24/7, 365, your focus is on getting better. You don't have time really for social media. Just don't have time. Social media is a full-time job. I can't keep up. I have 3 Facebooks, a YouTube, an Instagram, a Twitter, a TikTok. What's it called? TikTok?
Yeah, TikTok. Yeah,
I posted a few videos there. It's not enough times.
And that's my point exactly because it takes away from the boxers training.
So let the boxers just train. It's not their job to promote themselves. It would be nice if they did, but you can't do that, number one. Number two, the other point you brought up, you were talking about what do you say about fighters and how they talk. Listen, they're not professors from Harvard. Boxers are the most genuine people. What you see is what you get. Out of, let's say, 1,000 fighters that I met, there's only one or two I don't like because they're fake. Those that I don't like is because they're fake. But most boxers, they'll give you, I've had fighters give me like their shirt off their back, like, Elie, oh, you want, I want to give you something. They'll give me their ring robe and, you know, like, boxers are really, really, really good people. So just because you're not educated, you don't sound like you're a broadcaster on TV, doesn't mean you're not a great person. And
no, of course.
So from that, I mean, their job is to fight. Now, if they have extra crazy personality, it's a bonus, but not everybody has that.
Yeah. I'm just mainly mentioning because of the inspiration factor.
Yeah, no, it's
like,
true.
Like somewhere, I forgot, I think it was Frank that mentioned it when you were talking to him that, oh goodness, what is it that he mentioned? He mentioned something about, goodness, I forgot already. Damn it.
It's okay. No worries, man. But thanks so much for calling. My phone's about to die, so I'm going to end the live. But thanks. Stay up. Stay tuned. Thank you so much.
And thank you for what you're doing.
You're welcome. Of course. So there you have it. For ESNewsReporting.com, I'm Elie Seckbach reporting. And you can follow me on Twitter at Seckbach. You can follow me on Instagram at Elie Seckbach. Guys, I'll be back live maybe later today. It's only 9:50. It's early. Or I'll be live tomorrow morning. Reporting. Thank you so much for tuning in.